The next lecture by Dr. Guy Stiebel. Dr. Guy Stiebel is a senior lecturer in the Department of Archaeology and Ancient Near Eastern Culture at Tel Aviv University and the head of the archaeological expedition to Masada. He earned his PhD at University College London for the study of Militaria in Roman Palestine and held a postdoctorate position in the Hebrew University of Jerusalem for the study of the realia of the war scroll. Stiebel has published extensively on military archaeology and history, the interface between text and matter, and the archaeology of Jerusalem. Stiebel co-edited in the past decade the scientific series New Studies in the Archaeology of Jerusalem and its region and in Centro, and the book Roman Jerusalem, A New Old City, that was published as part of the Journal of Roman Archaeology. His monographs, Arms, Men, and Society in Roman Judea, is due this year in TNT, Clark, Bloomsbury Publishing House. Stiebel was recently nominated by Israel's Minister of Culture as the chair of the Israel Archaeological Council. And I will add to his CV that yesterday he signed the Israeli Declaration of Independence and the entry of the campus of Tel Aviv University as part of the protest. I have an inner information. Please, guys.
Thank you, Chair. And I wish to begin by thanking Maren for the kind invitation to participate in the conference, and not least to Ziva, Sima, and the entire team of the Academy for the efficient organization and warm welcome. Not a few of us spoke and will address the theme of mobility and movement from the point of view of pilgrimage, that is, a voyage with a certain destination. I, on the other hand, would like to offer 180 degrees point of view, that is, the movement in time of crisis, one that rather present an escape from a certain place that sought asylum, or in the word of a certain British philosopher, and now for something completely different. I would like to take you basically to the most remote place in Judea, in the land of Israel, in Palestine, to the Judean desert, which is runs from Jericho in the north all the way to Masada in the southern part of the Dead Sea, which you can see here, and a Google point of view, Google Earth point of view, you can see Masada itself. Well known, first of all, from the historical account, the narration of Flavius Josephus. This has been suggested by Robert Eisler, American scholar, to be identified with Josephus. I have no doubt that this is not the image of Josephus, and although I cannot prove it, I feel deeply inside that the reason for identifying it with the Jewish historian has something to do with the most prominent physical feature in the face of the proton, which is, with all due respect, a proper Roman nose, but we'll keep it on. The history of research of Masada dates back to the very early part of the 19th century, that's then 1806, referred to Eseba, a cursed mountain or mountain of curse, which is interesting, and I jump in time, it is 1950s, 1955 and 1956, you can see on the right-hand side Shmaria Gutman and Professor Yochanan Aharoni excavating the northern palace, the lower terrace at the northern palace with this beautiful, rare slide in color of the discovery of those beautiful frescoes. Of course, I'm on the shoulders of giants and the excavation of Yigael Yadin on behalf of the Hebrew University between 1963 and 1965 that literally put Masada on the map to pick up with the title of our conference, and scores of books and rivers of ink still are in the making. Some of them are still in the making, some 8 final volumes. I will not address that, the Hollywoodian part. Nevertheless, in the recent years, especially the last 2 decades, Masada became a focal point of criticism, scientific criticism. Some was directed by Professor Nachman Ben Yehuda at the scientific work of Yadin, despite the fact that I do have, till this very day, discussion post-mortem with Yadin. I do insist that this citation may have been a reason to take someone to court, well, at least a court of the academy, due to the fact that it still stands. The scientific work was perfectly done for the zeitgeist for the 1960s, and the chronology still stands. We have many debates about the interpretation, but there's not a shred of evidence for falsifying evidence or concealed facts or fake history or fake archaeology, if you'd like. Recently, several books, one that collected the information in a semi-popular way by Professor Amnon Bento and Jody Magnus, published a book recently about Masada, partly attacking, I would say, the reliability of Josephus' testimony towards the end, something that I don't have the time to relate to. One of the questions is, where do we go from here if we speak about a very short period of time, roughly 7-8 years between AD 66 to 73 or possibly 74? And I wish to share with you a shift in paradigm which has to do firstly with terminology, but also with the essence. Yadin spoke about Zilot at Masada, Josephus referred to Sicaria, I would like to remind you. And over the years, both Eud and I started to refer to, Eud Netzer and I started to refer to rebels at Masada. And I found the terminology of refugee highly productive. And basically, our expedition nowadays refer, on behalf of Tel Aviv University, refer to Masada during the time of the first revolt as a refugee camp. And when you think about putting the plague, the COVID-19 aside, what typified our world in the past 5 years or so, or last decade, was forced migration, movement of people throughout the world. And beside the obvious human tragedy, it is a sort of a lab. You can actually look at camps, and work like that is actually being carried out in France, in Germany, in the Greek islands, Turkey, of course, where people live, where they eat, where they cook, where they throw the garbage, where they celebrate, and so forth. And what I would like to share is taking this kind of point of view and applying it to 2 test cases, one during the first revolt at Masada, and a second one, if I'll have the time, during the Bar Kokhba revolt in those famous refuge caves that were excavated and actually are still being excavated in the past years. What is your package of memory? What do you take along with you? And part of it has to do, of course, dependence on the circumstances, whether you were surprised by the Russians, the Germans, the Romans, you name it, or you had time to prepare in advance. What is the distance to one need to walk or travel? What are the means of transportation? Do you have a donkey, a mule, or you walk by foot? There is, of course, dependence on age, gender, status, the essentials that one takes along, water, obviously, and food, but also from the point of view of material culture, cooking and storage, utensils, hunting tools, climbing and scaling equipment, especially in those sheer cliffs. Means of existence, money. What does it mean to take money in time of crisis? Hearing the news yesterday with a collapse of an American bank. Are we living in a time of crisis nowadays? But I'll avoid that. Weapons, protective measure, which can be also the protection of the god or gods, magic, charms, religious items, but also the emotional and sentimental factor, which I love dearly, is the ability to identify something that was important to someone to carry to a very remote place. And if I'll have the time towards the end, I will share with you what a Jewish Roman maternita, a lady, took to a very, very remote cave. At the end of the day, in places like Masada, we can actually speak not only about the archaeology of crisis and refugees, but we can speak about the archaeology of individuals. So to speak about the identity and the archaeology of individual is a challenge. But when we speak about the community of rebels at Masada or refugees, I want just to emphasize the understanding that we don't have one monolithic group. Josephus refers to the Sicarii, and I've published a Sica from En Gedi several years ago, and that was presumably the type of weapon that those extremists, if you wish, carried along. Nevertheless, as Professor Talmon demonstrated in Masada 6 a decade and a half ago, we do have an evidence for at least one Samaritan. I will not refer to a good Samaritan, but at least one Samaritan that joined the rebels, which is interesting due to the fact that Josephus is silent about the participation. We have evidence, both epigraphical evidence, but also archaeological evidence, as I attempted to demonstrate in a paper several years ago, about the presence of Essenes, or the sect of Qumran, at the site itself. And I've even suggested the location of a particular communal ritual bath and a dining hall, including pantry, like the one at Qumran next to Locus 77. But we may also speak about not only his history, but also about her story, and the possibility to relate to the presence of women at the site is extremely interesting. Also, to speak about literacy, the wife of Jacob, Bat Yaakov, or Bat Katra, possibly a member of the famous priestly family from the burnt house in Jerusalem. Speaking of girl power, Boaz Gross and I are very proud that all our aerial supervisor are female, which you can see Heidi, Ricky, and Angie. On the left-hand side, a group of workers, but I want to share with you one area and what we find in it when we speak about this kind of clusters of very, very small dwellings. One item, for example, troubled me. It is made of wood, there's no void in it, and it looks very much like a small jugglet from that period of time, but it can hardly be used as one. And I love crosswords, so every now and then when I tackle a problematic question, I tend to leave it aside or to look at it differently, and that was the case here. After 48 hours, I decided to look at it upside down, and I realized that we have actually the wooden handle of a key. Now, the fact that someone will bring along, he or she will bring along a key, which may be taken as a political symbol till this very modern day, is very interesting for itself. we find elements that was used even to a phenomenon, well, less common probably today, but once upon a time, especially in places like Masada, like refugee camps, you can see that. We even found the lice itself on the right-hand side, and I do apologize for the problematic photos. During the excavation, we find many evidence for the preparation of food, and after establishing that we have actually a central bakery on top of Masada, and despite the name that my surname is equivalent to a certain flour that is being produced in Israel, and I have no relation whatsoever to the family, but I don't know why, but we keep finding elements that refer to flour, as you can see here, kemach 16 or 6 drachma, so that's a bit of the production of the food and also the distribution in one given day, the 13th of months, Ab, give to a certain Bar Levi 1,020 loaves of white bread, something that may relate to the number also of the refugees or rebels at the site. But it's really interesting to see what people chose to take along, the one on the two jugs on the left-hand side, of course, from the Bar Kokhba caves that I'll show you later on, but you can see part of a handle, part of a situla, earrings, and a raven, which is really interesting to see how many of precious and semi-precious stone were brought to this site, presumably as a replacement of money. You can see Yashfe or Jasper, Niccolo Cabuchon, which sound like a love, an Italian lover, I think, but Niccolo is this black and blue, beautiful stone, and Cabuchon are the one, the intaglio, but without any stamp being carved in it. So this is one of the things that you take along as a refugee, and you can see how many were found in just one location. It may represent a purse or the pocket of a certain rebel. We always refer to urban or legends or urban myths, and the one in archaeology beside speaking about ritual or fertility, as was heard before, is that the last day, the last hour of the last day of the excavation, something will be found. And you can see our dear student, Ol Bluzman, he's on the autistic spectrum. He's now beginning his MA degree, and he's the one to find every last day of every year of excavation those precious finds. And I want to jump in time, some three generation or two generation towards the second Jewish revolt. And again, if we look at that wish list, if you'd like, and places like the Cave of Leta, excavated in the 1960-1961 by Adin, very, very deep cave. Obviously, you'll need something like oil lamps to show you the way, but storage tools or elements that were taken along, like this water skin that became basically a bag, baskets that contain hoard of actually Roman metal utensils. You can see this basket or a bedding or sitting or sleeping mat, avoiding parasite, especially in those caves, is really essential. Cooking utensils, and some were found by the IAA expedition very recently. You can see this net that was seemingly used for basically hunting birds, but some very, very precious elements that were taken to remote places that nowadays you need for descending into those caves. You basically, you need snapping equipment. So mind you, those beautiful glass vessels that were found by Igael Yadin in the 1960s were carried into the caves. We do find the same phenomenon of bringing along keys over and over again, those that were used, for example, for doors. Cosmetic equipment, one may go into this gender trap or slope and say, is belong to women, but you do know that, especially in the classical period, men were using jewelry as well. So you can see some of this jewelry box, for example. Money is really, really important, as we heard, and during the time of crisis, the more so, and in the twin cave, Hanan Eshel, the late Hanan Eshel, and Boaz Isso published a group of three purse, one of them, of rebels from the Bar Kokhba revolt. One of them was the most Zionistic ever. He had coins from the time of the Hasmonaim all the way to the first and second revolt. Another one, I think, was far more careful. And a third one invested only in Bitcoin or whatever you call it, only in Roman golden coins that was found here. And I would like to end with two very individual examples that demonstrate what people were fearing of or hoping for. This, what appears to be like a rag or textile, and please note those two knots that you see here, two pockets, is actually a tunic of a young male that you can see here. And when those knots were opened, the pockets were open, the team of Yadin discovered in it grains, salt, and other minerals. And they refer to what we read at Shabbat 66b. Three knots maintain the illness at its present state and prevent it from worthing. Five knots heal the illness, and seven are effective even against sorcery. So that might be a very fine example for magical charms that were supposed to protect a child that find asylum in a very, very remote cave. I would like to end with one example and one artifact only, which I came to face when I started my PhD on Roman weapons. It was published by Aharoni in the 1960s and was supposed to be a scabbard, the leather scabbard. But please note, you can see here gold, and it was published alongside some metal artifacts that were identified as weapons. I would like to refer to a citation by Imelda Marcus, who said that I didn't have 3,000 pairs of shoes, I had 1,060 only, if you wish, and would like to suggest that this is what we have here, something that was carried into the cave of horror. The name horror comes from skeletons that nowadays we know belong to much earlier period, to the Chalcolithic period, through the work of the team of the IAA recently. I think that the name Cave of Horror also came from the horror on the way down to the cave itself, but as I've mentioned, this assemblage was found in it. And what it turned to be that they are not weapons, although they look like sort of a small battle axe and a javelin, but they were actually elements that were used to cut leather. And what we have here is actually a slipper, a beautiful slipper that is decorated by floral design and filled with gold. An identical one, not with gold, was found in the Qumran, the British Qumran, if you'd like, Vindolanda, in the northern part of the empire. And we do know that this specific slipper actually belonged to a certain lady. Her name is Lepidina, the wife of the commander, and this wonderful text in which a friend of her, Claudia Severa, invite Lepidina to celebrate with her her birthday on the 11th of September. Sister, for the day of the celebration of my birthday, I give you a warm invitation to make sure that you come to us, and it goes on and on. You can even buy nowadays a ridiculous price of 140 British pound, but the slippers themselves. But if we speak about gilded slippers, slippers as such, that are gilded are known from Egypt. You can see a very, very, very unique example of a lion eating a boar, and you can see the two heads of goddesses on the right and left hand side. And when we speak about status, if I take you to Ravenna and to the gilded shoes of Theodora, this is a status. How come a gilded slipper, and that can be used only in a house, a very wealthy house, ended up in a cave, a very remote cave, at Nachal Chever? And I would like to offer to relate it to Rabbi Akiva, and especially his wife, Rachel, that after he had his breakdown at the age of 40 and decided that he is about to study, she had to sell her hair to finance him, he came back with thousands of students and said one of the most romantic sentences that we find, Shelach v'shelachem, Shelahu, mine and yours are hers, thanks to her. But nice words are not enough, and we know that he gave her a sort of a present, Jerusalem of gold, whether it was in the shape of the head of the Tiche, as you can see here, the shape of a city, or actually a diadem or a crown. There is a big debate, but mind you that Avod Rabbi Natan, version B, chapter 12, it was said that he, Rabbi Akiva, did not die until he slept on golden beds and made a golden crown that we saw and gave kordikos of Zahav, kordikos, basically a slipper kordikos in Latin, for his wife. Again, this is from the time of Bar Kokhba. Rabbi Akiva is the leader, religious leader of the Bar Kokhba revolt. I'm not nearly suggesting that this has to do with the realia and what you see here is the slipper of Rachel. Of course not. Nevertheless, it's really interesting to see that sometimes the realia can echo, if you wish, or the text may echo the realia of what we find. And a certain lady chose to take that along with her, and I would like to finish by quoting Midrash Esther Rabba, referring to a certain angry and very rightly so woman that slapped the face of her husband with a slipper. The slipper is the kordikon. So, if you'd like, the war between gender is an ancient one, but referring to the artifacts, I think it's just another example of what people in time of crisis choose to take along with them, presumably with the hope to use them again. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Guy, for reminding us about the mobility of refugees that regretfully is still happening today, as you've shown us. I open the floor for questions, please.
Regarding this parallel studies of modern refugee camps in Calais and other sites, you showed examples of study of architecture. Do the research includes also the study of artifacts, of memoirs, of things that people are taking with them?
Yes, it starts with artifacts. It goes on to graffiti and an interesting phenomenon that I just published a paper is about is the fact that at Masada we have one of the greatest collection of ostraca from that period of time. And I suggested that time of crisis actually increase the need to leave a mark, sometimes on the wall, as in graffiti. We do have evidence, for example, from Masada, for curses, for blessings that were written. We have the same phenomenon in the Judean desert that Yossi Patrick published several years ago from Nachal Michmash. And I think at the end of the day, you do see the same element in camps alike. There was another example not far away from your site at Nisana, at Cholot, where seekers of asylums, especially from Africa, were housed, so to speak, or jailed in that camp, and the artistic work was staggering. They're insistent to write their names and so forth to leave a mark. I think it's part of this phenomenon, and I can see equivalent from ancient time in the same, very same way.
questions or comments? Yes, Maren.
Thank you. Listening to your lecture, I'm struck by the kind of diversity of the evidence, both geographically, Masada in the Bar-Kochba materials, and also this golden shoe is obviously seems. I mean, for me, at first sight, at least, it struck me that there is you have a golden shoe, but then you flee to this cave. So my question would be, I mean, can we say anything about why somebody as rich to buy this kind of very precious shoe? Why did they have any other options of fleeing rather than this cave? And what is the kind of the geography of these refugees, and can we really talk about camps? I mean, there seem to be some scattered caves, or am I wrong?
Thank you. I'll start from the end. Obviously, the story or the circumstances of the second revolt is different from the first revolt when I refer to that area. The caves are something different, although you can see a group of people finding shelter there and their cooking activity and so forth. But we do have an example from Herodium, for example, that hopefully we'll see tomorrow, for something rather similar like Masada, where people from all over the place gathered. In the letters of Bar-Kochba, he's referring to people who came from the Galilee, for example, and ended up at Tekoa, not far away from Herodium, and he's threatening, if anyone will do any harm to those Galilean, I will put ropes, or I will tie or bound your legs the same way I did to a certain Ben Aflul. So you can actually see the interrelation between those group of rebels or refugees, if you'd like. When it comes to what one take along, we're now studying cave by cave, or at Masada, area by area, and you can actually see from the cluster of artifacts, it mirrors sometimes gender, sometimes age, even to a certain degree. I'm very careful to speak about ideology or different streams within Judaism back then. You can even see status. Immanuel Toh, for example, indicated that the Torah scrolls that were brought are must have come from Jerusalem, and he actually suggests the Temple Mount, so priests ended up, so you can actually start looking at them quarter by quarter, family by family, or area by areas. And some of the people insist to bring something valuable. Now, if we'll make a questionnaire here, I'm sure all of us will take the laptop. Our parents probably took photograph albums, and we can think about all kind of tactics during pogroms, Holocaust, and so forth. People decided to put things in their shoe, or to take a jewelry that was important, that came down as a heirloom in the family. But at the end of the day, it's really very individual. Why this lady decided to take the slipper, I don't know, but it's something humane that I think everyone can understand. She was not using that to walk to the cave or down the cliff, for sure. It was taken as part of her parcel of belongings, memory, whatever. But at the end of the day, I think it's something very, very individual of this mechanism of what you choose. And again, it's really dependent if someone was knocking at your door and you need to flee immediately, so you'll take yourself. But if you have time to prepare, we do have evidence for some preparation, installation, at En Gedi, for example, at Nachal David, we can see a preparation of sort of a pool, plastered pools that was prepared in advance. We see the same phenomenon in the Galilee, a work by Inon Shevtiel that demonstrated the long durée of people finding asylum in places like that over the years. And some of them prepared that as a sort of a milna, or that you can find your shelter in the attic or down below in time of need. We can see it in the region of Bet Guvrin, and there are different tactics, but I think at the end of the day, it's very individual.
Maybe you mentioned it, but I didn't hear it. But I was thinking about the Palestinian myth of the keys, taking keys of their houses in the hope of coming back. And you show this this device of making keys. Mm-hmm. So does it hint at a hope of going back, of returning, of myth of return, or something like that? Can you see something like that?
I was exactly hinting to that without stating the exact word when I said that this symbol is still used politically nowadays. But yes, I mean, it may be practical. Someone locked the door and abandoned his or her house and brought the key. We do have a phenomenon in late antique period of abandoned houses in the Negev, and people debate fiercely, and thank God it's not my battle, but there are a few warriors, very furious warriors actually sitting one next to each other. What was the reason behind the abandonment? But, you know, doors were, or openings were blocked and so forth. So people may be practical, but some of them may be more symbolic, sentimental about it. I can relate to another example. We know the name of Masada from a divorce deed that was found in Muabat cave during the second revolt period. And it's mentioned there in Aramaic that it was signed at Masada. Now, it's not my opinion about the institution of marriage, but this divorce saved the woman's life. She avoided the tragic end at Masada, and yes, I do believe that they committed suicide at the end, but that's another story. I'm mentioning it because a granddaughter of that certain Miriam, some 60 years thereafter, brought the divorce deed with her. So keeping, and of course, it's not only ritual, it's not only symbolic, I think it has to do, like today, when we go to the Rabbanut, we need to demonstrate that this is our parents and they got married or divorced and so forth. So that's part of the bureaucracy. And I think some of the people, as we can see from the archive of Babata, thank God she took the entire house. And you can see all the documents. And so it's very individual. Part of it is symbolic, as you very rightly suggested. Other is very, very practical, but again, we can ask ourselves what we would do. Thank you.
Out of all the lectures, you might have talked at least about any religious iconography. I might have missed some. But were there any, or were they more busy with survival? And I think it was interesting, you said not only religious, but magic. So was it anything pagan? Was there diversity of religion, things like that?
So I did refer to it briefly by saying that, for example, you do see some activity, mainly epigraphic, people writing on the wall, cursing, or cursing the Romans, for example, it has been suggested, or hoping for the divine forces. enough reading Flavius Josephus' Bellum Judaicum, and you can see that people were looking for signs in the sky, in the shape of the clouds even, and so forth, Jews during the siege. We do have evidence for magical activity. This is a shirt, is one very, very rare but very fine example for that, that those grains and mineral was supposed to protect this specific child from any harm. And we do have amulet. By the way, both sides used it, because even for the besieging Romans, this was a dire situation. And we have found amulets of goddesses like Isis or Eastern Eros, Hippocrates, that were carried by Roman soldiers. Participating in a conference, I'm on thin ice here, but I'll try to be as delicate as possible. But after a colleague of mine, Rob Collins, published what hit the news everywhere 2 weeks ago, that he found a self-indulgence wooden tools, i.e. a Roman dildo from Vindolanda, I was able to write to him that yours is bigger than mine. And I do apologize for that, but I'm referring to the fact that we found a wooden phallus at Masada, and it was used as a charm to protect a Roman horse or a Roman wagon. And we have an evidence for that by Pliny the Elder, who is referring to the fact that during the triumph, under the carriage of the Caesar, something like that hanged. So even for the Romans, although there were the victorious side and the more advanced and so forth, they also recruited the gods and their assistants to their safekeeping.
Thank you very much. I want to mention this slide where you showed what one takes along. At the end of the slide, you mentioned the emotional part of it, the souvenirs and so on. Now, we know that refugees are actually traumatized people. They have been through war. They've been driven out of their homes. And we know about the phenomena of nostalgia among immigrants, especially in this country, which is a country of immigrants. So do you have any texts or documents or letters from that time referring to the emotions of these people?
Yes and no. I think that when you read Josephus, and he's playing, he wears two hats, so to speak. One of it is a historian, but he cannot avoid his personal experience, being also a captive and so forth, away from home, ending up in Rome. And I think part of it is being echoed in between the lines when you read it carefully. When it comes to the senses of the hope, I think you should ask actually the chair, because in Rina's wonderful book about Mosaic, one of the things that you can see are what was the visual package of memories that were carried along, and obviously the menorah and the image of the temple. But that's something more for the nation rather than a personal. I may add another national aspect, which is a use, which I think is an act also of resistance, is the use of the ancient script of the first temple on the coinage in the first revolt and also in the second revolt. Which was also a sort of a manifestation of the old Judea, if you'd like, and the good old days, so to speak, and hoping to gain back what was destroyed and what was long gone. The strategy obviously changed following the second revolt and the elimination of Judaism, at least in Judea. We have it moved to the Galilee, but that's something completely different. But if you look on various mosaic floor in synagogue, but also on writing on the walls at Rehov and other places, you can see the message of the nostalgia the practice, even referring to the borders of the land of Israel and so forth, as we can see in the inscriptions. So, that, but that became more institutionalized rather than what I think you're after, which is a personal aspect, which I can see very few examples that may be quoted. One of them, as I've mentioned, Yossi Patrick's discovery in Nachal Michmash, is a name of a person, and he's referring to the fact that the Romans are coming, literally putting that, like leaving his last memoir or note on the wall. That's roughly about it.
Thank you very much, Guy.